Thank you. today. If you see a seat, please go ahead and sit there, please. And we are going to get started in a moment. Thank you.
If you are still looking for a seat, we do have some seats that say reserved. We're going to open those up for anyone that needs to still need a seat. Hello, everybody. How y'all doing this evening? Now, I need y'all to talk to me. How y'all doing this evening? We are here for a historic event about to happen in this building, okay? Come on, give me some applause. We want to thank you all again for coming. My name is Shaki Moore. I serve as a presidential project specialist in the office of the president. So I'm going to go ahead and start with a land acknowledgement to really honor the land that we stand on today. So we acknowledge with respect the land our campus is on today was and continues to be the homeland of the indigenous people of this area, the Nisim, Palanan, Nisenan, and Miwok. The larger Sacramento area and its rivers serve as a gathering place for many local tribes from the surrounding valleys and foothills, including the Southern Maidu, Patwin, and Wintu. We recognize these land and riverways as unceded traditional territories of these native people. We further recognize these California Native Nations and respect their sovereignty. By offering this land acknowledgement, we affirm a commitment to build relationships and foster a university environment of success to better serve Native nations and communities.
So now I'm going to bring up Dean of Students, Dr. Ivy Masupie.
Award, Martin Luther King Jr. Community Impact Award, the California FEC Summit Social Justice Award, Ubuntu Award for Inspiring Social Change, Outstanding Service in African American Community Award, just a few. University of California Davis, the Points of Pride Award, I am proud to say that Patrice Hill was my former student, and she said I should say this. While she took all of my classes while she was a student here, Dr. Wood, man.
Let's welcome Patrice Hill.
I had to make sure she plugged that in there because I took all her classes. It's so beautiful to be here, y'all,
to see so many professors that inspired my journey and poured directly into me. Before there was a Black Honors College, there were Black professors here that poured into students every single day and gave us the tools and the strength that we need. I walked these halls with Dr. Luke Wood, and did a lot of work here. So this poem is called Black Honors College. Every black scholar deserves to have a legacy. However, in my city, it seems like there has been an intentional campaign for the pain and lack of educational attainment for black babies. Black children's educational trajectories have been hammered with atrocities and inequities, harmful discipline policies, lack of cultural relevancy, lack of black educators to protect our most precious legacies. Every black scholar deserves to have a legacy and a college degree. I am sure the ancestors weaved and wept and wanted to taste freedom like we taste good lemonade and weave that pain into purpose, never complacent with conditions of oppression. Weaving together African spirituality systems and resistance. We are weaving together wonders of words where we wish to improve the condition in which the world of which our children live in. Creating systems for racial justice to exist in. Organizers and educators, parents and liberators, movement shakers, we are elevating our work more collectively. We envision a collective possibility to intersect organically, intentionally intersect organizing the remedy to name our common causes rooted in our vision to move the movement forward. In our mission to work more closely and document our stories, shine light on our brothers and sisters who rarely get the glory. In the trenches, challenging systems, organizing for resistance. This movement is ours to name and exist within. Small but mighty, organized and timely, righteously divine. Our focus intention is to dismantle the school, the prison pipeline, and graduate black scholars from college. Graduate black scholars from college on time. Movement Builders Unite. Sac State Black Honors College, a university within a university. Providing a tailored, specialized education to ensure black future generations succeed. We know every black college that enrolls, we know that every black scholar that enrolls in college doesn't leave with a degree. And since we know every black scholar deserves to have a legacy, look at what black student access and success has the potential to achieve. Ensuring our scholars graduate in a timely manner and have the academic support, mentorship, extracurricular, and specialized pathways black scholars truly need. It can be extremely hard as a black scholar to navigate through a predominantly white university. I think of how much academic potential students will see when the curriculum is centered on the black experience and culturally responsive we. We'll see academic achievement and graduation rates we didn't know that we could achieve. When the resources are gathered and the investments are made to improve retention and graduation amongst our future generations, I know the ancestors are celebrating. I know the scholars have been waiting to have an experience rooted in authentic black experience. I know it's been a long time coming, but leave it up to our people's president to ensure the Black Honors College is more than a thought but manifest into existence. Challenging systems, we do more than resist. We continue to work for the people to make dreams for black scholars come true. Sac State Black Honors College, it's been a long time coming. We have been waiting for you. We as a community can't wait to see all the degrees Black scholars will attain through the nation's first Black Honors University. A university within a university. Here to establish Black educational trajectories, because we know every Black scholar deserves to have a legacy. And we know at Sac State, the Black Honors College will succeed. So praise be to the scholars poised to be graduates and leave Sac State with their fingers up. And most importantly, a college degree, because every Black scholar deserves to have a legacy. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Patrice. That was absolutely beautiful. I would love to get a copy of that and share that with our incoming cohort of the Black Honors College this fall. My name is Anisha Mitchell, and I serve as the Vice President for Student Affairs at Sac State. Thank y'all so much for being here with us today on this rainy, cold Monday evening. It means so much, and you could have chosen to be anywhere but here. Yet you chose to be here with us today. And for that, we are incredibly grateful. So sincerely, we thank you. At this time, I would like to recognize any esteemed dignitaries who were able to join us this evening. If we have any elected or appointed government officials, we ask that you please stand and briefly introduce yourselves, sharing your name, role, and the area that you are representing. I'll make sure everyone heard you.
And I also serve as a governor's appointee to the California Community Colleges Board of Governors. Yes. Thank you.
Hi, good evening. Bina Lefkowitz. I am the president of the Sacramento County Board of Education, and I'm extremely pleased to be here, and congratulations.
Thank you.
And thank you for being here with us this evening. Now, I have the distinct honor of introducing someone who honestly needs no introduction. He has worn and still wears many hats. To some, he is known for his work as the Chief Diversity Officer and Vice President for Student Affairs and Campus Diversity at San Diego State University, where he had a reputation for being a voice for those who have been silenced, ears for those who have historically been unheard, and eyes for those who have felt invisible by implementing policies that created a more welcoming and safer campus community for underrepresented minoritized community members, and in turn for all. He is known as a distinguished professor of education and a researcher who has authored and co-authored a series of research reports shedding light on the inequitable treatment of Black children, youth, and foster care in school disciplinary proceedings, some of which have led to the creation of laws to combat that. He is a scholar, having been recognized in 2023 as being in the top 1%, yes, top 1% of influential education scholars in the nation. He earned a PhD in educational leadership and policy studies with an emphasis in higher education and a master's degree in curriculum and instruction in early childhood education from Arizona State University. He's also made at Sac State with a master's degree in higher education leadership in student affairs and a bachelor's degree in Black history and politics from Sacramento State. In addition to being a professor, researcher, and scholar, he's a husband to Dr. Adara Essien, father of three, mentor, visionary leader, and change maker. He is called many things, and I am so honored to be able to call him our president. I introduce to you the 9th president of California State University, Sacramento, President Luke Wood.
appreciate that. So thank you, everyone, for coming out this evening. It's an absolute pleasure to see you here, to be in fellowship with you, and to be able to talk about the work that we're going to be doing here. As was mentioned, my name is Luke, and I am very proud to be serving as the president for Sacramento State. If you're an alum of this institution, can you just make some noise and see who we got in the room? All right. And if you're not an alum and you're a supporter, we're grateful for your presence. So we're going to get this set up. As we get going, I can just talk a little bit about what was the impetus for wanting to do this. So if you look across California right now, there's a lot of students who are... there's a lot of students who are leaving California to go elsewhere because the perception is that the Cal State system and the UC system have failed the black community. And as a result, they're heading out of state. For some of them, it's an amazing opportunity to go to a historically black college or university or to an out-of-state institution that's a minority-serving institution that can create the kind of environment that they want to be at. But we also know that not everyone can do that, and that not every environment is going to be perfectly situated for each student. And so when we were looking at our data and realized that we have, you know, we're proud to be a Hispanic-serving institution, which means we have a number of students who are from the Latinx community, and we're also proud to be an Asian American, Native American, Pacific Islander-serving institution in Anapizi, which means we have a high population of students who are Asian and Pacific Islander. But what most people didn't know is that we have the largest population of black and African American students in the entire Cal State system. And out of all the CSUs and UCs, we're the second largest black serving institution in the state. So if anybody should be doing something that's focused on black student success, it should be the primary place that is enrolling them. But you know, as we'll get to when we're talking about this, access is not always synonymous with success. And so as a result, we need to make sure that we're doing the right things by our black students and making sure that they have an experience where they are educated, where people extol their brilliance, their dignity, and their morality. So before I go any further, I will say I see folks standing up there. If you've got a seat open next to you, can you just slip up your hand? Okay, here we go. We got pews here in the front. All right. Okay. Yeah, we got some more up here in the front. You still got space? Help me keep the hands slipped up. All right, we got one here. We got a couple there. I also know that some folks may want to stand because they're closer to that food in the back. That's okay. It was pretty good. All right. So we're going to talk a little bit about essentially what the vision is for the Black Honors College, what we're trying to accomplish, and then what you see here, this is the leadership team. And so each one of them is going to have an opportunity to respond to questions that folks submitted. So we're joined by the people who are here in this room, but also how many folks do we have joining us online right now?
300.
All right. Okay, so one of the important context for this, and this is a live link, so if you want to get that on your phone and follow it, you can take a look at the report. So I was fortunate to be part of an effort that was put into place by the prior chancellor of the CSU system, and that was to form a group looking at black student success and to try to understand what is going wrong that's taking place in our system. And so I was fortunate that I was at San Diego State at the time, and so I got selected. And then also Dr. Marceline Watson-Verbigny, who many of you know, she was also on the same group and represented Sacramento State. And so basically, we collected data from students, from faculty, from staff across the system, focus groups, interviews, just trying to understand what is the black experience, whether you're a student, faculty member, or staff member. And as you might expect, everything was glowing and there was no problems. Okay, so maybe not. We knew that there were some issues and that we had to basically delve into what that experience looks like. And basically what we heard is that it can almost be marvelous. And not saying that necessarily in a good way, but just marvelous for the idea of that, where you could have two students in the same classroom, same faculty members, same walls, same environment, same desks, same chairs, and they can have two wildly different experiences. And the biggest difference was based upon their ranks. And that not only did the student experience help to inform what it looked like for faculty and staff, but basically for our Black faculty and staff, they felt disconnected, isolated, alienated, and not always valued in the ways that they should be. And so what we recognize from this is that we needed to do something as a system. And so basically the report is titled Advancing Black Student Success and Elevating Black Excellence in the CSU, a call to action. But you can't do a call to action if there's no action. And so one of the things that the system did is they said, okay, each campus, we want you to put together what are the things that you're going to do to advance the recommendations that came from this report. So here's some context for that. Here's some of the things that students said about it. Going from, if it's highlighted in green, it's more positive to more negative responses. You can see most of the responses are more on that side. On the positive side, students said, I go to the Black Resource Center. I like having a place away from home, a way to connect to other Black men on campus, a place to talk, just to have a voice, a place to share problems or aspirations. And so having a places and spaces and community we know is very important for students, because at some point in time, you have to be able to be in community with people who look like you, understand you, and want to see you inherently succeed, which is not what always happens. Other students talked about challenges. Money and resources are put into getting Black students to attend CSU, but no effort is put into retention. There are too few Black faculty and staff, and these small numbers don't have enough power or job security to be effective in support of Black students. Another thing that was said is Black student success is not embedded in the campus community. If not for the Black faculty and staff, we would not have representatives. And I was fortunate that I had such an amazing experience being here, but I succeeded in spite of Sacramento State, not because of it, and it was because of a group of Black faculty and Black staff and some allies who created an experience for myself and for others. But we also know that too few are succeeding and graduating from the institution. And when we look at differences in outcomes, we don't immediately go to blaming students, blaming their families, and blaming their communities. Instead, we've tried to look into the mirror and say, what is it that we're doing or not doing that's resulting in the outcome differences that we see? And we had to basically acknowledge that we have structures and systems and policies and practices that are perfectly designed to produce the disparate outcomes that we see. And so if we want to change the outcomes, then we have to change the system. And that's what this is all about. So the report highlighted 8 recommendations for campuses, 13 recommendations overall. Anybody guess why we had 13 recommendations? 13th what? 13th Amendment, right? And so 8 recommendations that specifically dealt with what campuses are supposed to do. And they're basic things, right? Because the truth is, everybody could tell you generally. I'm a student success researcher. I've been doing research on Black students my entire career. And I could tell you that 90% of people could tell you what it takes to ensure that Black students succeed. But the vast majority of those people could never put it into practice, because it's not about knowing what to do, it's having the heart to actually do it. So the first thing that you can see was creating a plan for outreach, then having a plan, a comprehensive strategy for enrollment, and a comprehensive plan for retention and persistence. Basically, you gotta have a plan to know where you're going. Where there is no plan, the people perish, right? And so having that as a roadmap. Thinking about creating a welcoming environment with affirming spaces. Developing and implementing inclusive curriculum that's reflective of the student's life and the student's experience. For those of you who aren't familiar, there's a concept in reading education called mirror books and window books, right? So a mirror book is where you have like a young child and they're, I'm gonna actually start with window. With window book is where you have a young child and they're reading a book, and the storylines and the characters are like looking out the window into someone else's life and someone else's experience. Whereas a mirror book is when you're reading a book and the stories, the storylines, the characters, and the people are reflective of you. And so having an educational experience that's reflective of you is absolutely critical to your success. And I can speak from that from a personal perspective, because when I went to school at Sacramento State, let's just say advising then is not as good as advising is now. And so for the first 2 years of college, I did nothing but take my major classes in Black history, Black government, ethnic studies. Like, that's all I did for the first 2 years. And then after the first 2 years, then I realized there's this whole thing called general education. And I was like, oh man, you gotta be kidding me. Like, you go from a class on like Black hip hop, or you go to a class on like Papa Doc Duyaye or Black civil rights, and like all these amazing things. And then after that, then you're in geology 101. It's like, oh, come on. But I was actually glad that that happened. And I'm gonna tell you why. I don't know if I would have finished otherwise. Because I was in an environment where I was taught by educators who looked like me, educators who cared about me, a curriculum that was responsive to where I was coming from, and I had confidence. I wasn't beaten down, I was built up. And too often what we find is that after students get to their first couple of years, whether they're coming here as a transfer from a community college, or whether they're coming here and they've been here for a couple of years, after those first couple of years, it's interesting to see how that dignity can be stripped away. And so having a curriculum that's relevant, having spaces that are designed for students is critical and important. Having faculty members here who we invest in and that we're supporting themselves, and making sure that as we hire faculty, that they have a demonstrated record of success in teaching and serving Black students. So those are the things that came out in the report. And then, so the CSU system said, we want you to identify every single campus, what are the things that you're going to do to advance the recommendations in the report? And they wanted us to give several things that we're going to do as a campus. And we came back and said, no, we're not going to pick several things and do several things mediocre. We're going to pick one thing and we're going to do one thing well. And that is to do something that has never been done before outside of an HBCU, which is to have an honors college that is specifically designed to serve students who are from the Black community, those who are interested in Black history, Black life, and Black culture. And to use that as a way to create a protected environment so that students are leaving having their brilliance, their dignity, and their morality extolled, right? So those are the things that we were trying to accomplish with this, is to not do a bunch of things, but to do one thing and do one thing well, so that we could truly create the experience that our students deserve. Now, how the genesis of how about, you know, why do it as a Black Honors College? Because there's a lot of different ways in which you could create one intervention that's designed to try to support Black students. Some campuses say, hey, we're going to go all in on one resource center, right? Or we're going to go all in on employee resource groups, whatever it could be, right? But we said it was going to be this. Part of it came from the first 100 days that I had here. We basically did listening sessions. And some of you were actually part of those listening sessions as I look out on this audience. And basically we did 92 listening sessions, an hour and 15 minutes each. It was exhausting and inspiring at the same time, because we learned what our students are in need of. And what it came down to is really what the research says works with HBCUs. Create an environment where you have people who are supporting one another, who are also representative of that same community. Have that environment be family-like, lots of support, culturally relevant, and to think about how do we resource an experience that looks like that rather than one that basically treats our students with distrust, disdain, and disregard. And so we came up with this action item from the strategic plan. To implement the Chancellor's Office Black Student Success recommendations by establishing the Sacramento State Black Honors College. Not by fall of 2027.
Come on now.
Or fall of 2026. But if we're going to do it, we're going to do it now, because justice delayed is justice denied.
Yeah.
So by fall 2024, that means that this upcoming fall and beginning tomorrow, students can basically begin to apply, which is amazing. And I gotta tell you, you see all these folks, they're all dressed up nicely and looking really, really sharp right now. But this is a beleaguered team because this is a lot to get this done in a short amount of time, right? And so we're very proud that we're gonna be moving forward and doing this. So let me introduce you to this leadership team here that you see. You already met our Vice President for Student Affairs, Anisha Mitchell. You've already met Dr. Ati Fawatomusupie, who's our Dean of Students. You've already met, well, maybe not met yet, there's also Ruth Williams. All right. Who is serving as our inaugural director, and Dr. Ati is our inaugural Dean of Students. You have Linnea Lewis. She's the public information officer for Sacramento State and is really just a creative mind that's helping us to think differently about how we approach this. And then we have Shaki Moore. Now, Shaki and I, and Michael Wiafe, who I see over there, are all from, as well as Anisha. And Mark, okay. There's a few of us. We're all from San Diego State, right? And I met Shaki when he was a student leader there. And he went on to become the student body president. He's also in a fraternity. And and despite the fraternity he's in, I felt it important. We give each other a lot of back and forth. But he's a brilliant, brilliant mind. And when we were coming here, we're like, we've got to bring Shaki with us because we want to be able to make sure that we're having someone who's closer to that student experience, but also understands how college and university works. And so he's an invaluable member of this team. We also have an advisory board. And if you are a member of the advisory board, if you could just stand up. I've got a few folks in the room. So if we do anything right, I want you to thank the advisory board. And if we do anything wrong, I want you to blame me. But they'll be helping us to think through all aspects of the work that needs to be done because, as you can imagine, undertaking of this size requires an incredible amount of planning and detail. In terms of the structure, so I kept on seeing this online, where there were some articles and stories that came out, and they kept referring to this as a program. This is not a program. This is a college. Yes. And so I should explain what that means. An honors program, and there's actually standards that are out there that are national standards. Usually you have one or two people who are involved and who are coordinating it. You have a set aside number of classes that students are taking. You can have an honors, for example, there's an honors program that I can think of that has one class. There's some that have four or five classes, but they're much more narrowly tailored. Oftentimes, they're focused on a particular discipline, like a business honors program or an engineering honors program or a chemistry honors program. Now, some universities do have larger honors programs that go beyond one particular discipline, but the main point is that it's a program based upon the resources that are being put into it, right? The resources being a small number of folks who are involved, a small number of students who are involved. Now, what transitions you from an honors program to an honors college is based upon, do you have set alone space? Do you have the number of people who are working with and involved in the effort? And we're not talking about two people. And one of the things that we worried about when we announced that we were doing this is that we expect that there's going to be some other universities out there that copy this. And in fact, we want them to. But we don't want them to be performative in doing so, in that there has to be the requisite resources to go along with it. Otherwise, you're sending a false promise to a community that continues to get those false promises. And so what you'll see is that we have, on the staff side, eight people who will be working with the with the Black Honors College. So led by Dr. Ati, as I mentioned before, and also by Ruth, who's serving as the staff director. And then we've got a few folks who are also in the room, who we appreciate them being here, who are also gonna be part of this. So they'll have a standalone administrative coordinator, standalone retention advisors, standalone therapists, counselors working directly with the students, their own academic advising, their own outreach. So we're talking about truly an institution within the institution. So we're not talking about one person or two people. This is 8 staff members. That's not counting all the faculty members who are going to be involved in this. And as our long-term trajectory, we want to get to 500 initially. And then based upon whether or not we can secure more resources, we want to go bigger than that. And all of that is based upon a multi-million dollar investment from this university. And everyone who works in public education will tell you, there's not a lot of money in a college or university. So this is a significant investment because it's a community that's in desperate need of something more than we've been giving them. Our 75-year history has shown that we have not been as successful as we should be in graduating and supporting Black students. And part of that is because, when the words of W. Everett Deming and Paul Batalden, every system is perfectly designed to achieve the results that it gets. So, as I said before, if we want to change the outcomes, then we have to change the system. And that's what we're doing here. So you'll also see on the left-hand side here, faculty members who are going to be teaching in the program. And why are we in this space? Because this is where the seminars are going to be held. Right? So not only did we want you to come and hear about the work that is going to be done, but we wanted you to see. This is one of the first rooms around the corner, and around the corner from here are some additional spaces, and I'll tell you a little bit about that. In terms of the organizational model, what does this look like? Well, first of all, there's accelerated specialized coursework through general education. So your GE, the classes that you take across all disciplines, basically what we're doing is we're identifying classes that let's say that you have to complete a GE class in political science or in history or in statistics. We're identifying those classes that specifically have a focus on the Black experience. Right, so I was fortunate, we were fortunate, we had Black political science with David Coven and Otis Scott, right? I had Black history and African history from Dr. Gaston, somewhere in here, right there, right? So imagine that's how the curriculum is being built out, is that there, not only are you taking these classes to complete your general education, but the classes that you're taking are specifically focused on the Black and Pan-African experience. And taught by faculty members, most importantly, who have a demonstrated record of success in teaching and serving Black students. And later on, Dr. Ati will explain exactly what we mean by that. There's gonna be bi-weekly seminars focused on economic empowerment, self-determination, and courageous leadership. Those are the 3 main pillars of all the programming that takes place outside of the classroom. So there's a residential, for example, living and learning component. That will be the focus of that programming. In other words, we're living together, right? There's a curriculum that's gonna be taking place in terms of what's happening with student affairs and the student programming. Those will be the main pillars of it. There's a study center that we've set aside. So not only is there this physical space and the office suite, but there's also their own center on campus for them to be able to spend time together. You can think of it as a lounge, you can think of it as an academic study space, so that we can infuse academic advising, tutoring, supplemental instruction, and the things that we know are important for students to succeed. There'll be paid internships that'll be part of it, as part of our institutional goal to have more students who are graduating having completed internships. There'll be distinctive opportunities for students to participate in research and or creative endeavors. And as I mentioned, there'll be specialized residential living and learning program. In fact, is Samuel here from housing? Right there. Is our director of housing right there? Or executive director? Sorry. He's like, get it right. By the way, you would be surprised how many times me and this brother get confused for one another. It's like, really? Okay. All right. So program requirements. All right. So it's an honors college. So there is a GPA requirement. The GPA requirement is meant to serve as a motivation for students to want to focus and succeed. So there's 2 pathways to get in. First pathway is you apply, graduating from high school. And that's a 3.5 GPA. You'll see an asterisk there because there'll always be exceptions depending upon the student's background, the student's experience. For example, when I was at San Diego State, my godson went to San Diego State. He had a 3.2 GPA. And just so you know, the 3.2 GPA does not get you into San Diego State, right? And he had a 3.2 GPA, black male, but he had a 3.2 GPA, hadn't been homeless for 4 years. So when you hear someone's got a 3.2 GPA and they've been homeless, right? Then you're like, no, that's a badge of honor, right? And so we want to make sure that we're being attentive to the fact that people come from different situations and different conditions. The second is the part of this is if you're going to be continuing the program, we need you to maintain a 3.2 GPA, and our staff can talk to you about what that means, right? So there is some continuation expectations. So some students will come in as frosh. Other students will come in having transferred from a community college or having been here at Sacramento State and completed their GE. So an entry-level pathway and then a pathway for those who've completed their general education, whether they're transfer or they're students who've already been here. Then there'll be, as I mentioned, there'll be study hours. There'll be, the requirement is that students will have to participate in 80% of the events that are going on that are part of the programming. We don't want to over-program students, but we also want to make sure that they're in an environment that is a safe place and that they're not being exposed to damage. And there'll also be a community service requirement, and that was actually based upon feedback that we received from our faculty in terms of what they wanted to see as part of what, what's taking place here. And I have to say that there's, I think, a lot of opportunities for partnership with, for example, the Roberts Family Development Center. I think that there's opportunities for us to also think about the fact that Sacramento is home to, as Kai can tell you, some of the worst suspensions in all of California. And so I'm hopeful that some of the work that can be done can help to curb some of the ailments that we have here that are very unique to Sacramento. In terms of how the courses are structured, they're going to be in 8-week blocks, which is different than what our most of our students experience. So this is an accelerated program. So the first 8 weeks, you take 3 classes, and based upon those contact hours, it means basically one day is one class, another day is one class, another day is in a class, right? So then they'll take their next 8 weeks, which will then be another set of 3 classes. So they're taking classes in 8-week blocks, 3-unit classes, taught by faculty members who have a demonstrated record of success. With those classes, focusing on Black history, life, and culture throughout the general education. So that's the experience that students are going to be getting as part of it. In other words, they'll be spending a lot of time in this room. In terms of the planned growth, our ultimate target right now, based upon the dollars that we have in hand and the resources that we have available, is going to be around 500 to 600 students. Our goal long-term would be able to be to 1,000, but that's going to be based upon whether or not we can continue to secure resources necessary, with the most important part being scholarships for students. So in the first year, in fall of 2024, opening up again tomorrow, is basically those who are part of the entry-level students, frosh or freshmen. So we'll be taking 70 students. We would love to take 200. We can only take 70 because we got to make sure that not only do we do something, but that we do it right. Okay. Then the following semester, we'll then take the transfer students or those who are GE completers who have been here at Sacramento State. And we have a lot of students who are already very interested and being part of this, we'll take 50. So in that first year, we'll be 120. And then the next year, we'll go to, instead of 70 in the frosh cohort, we'll go to 100, and we'll stay steady at that unless, again, we're able to grow based upon additional resources. And so if you think about it, over time, we're going to get to a pretty good size in terms of the experience. Now, for those who are coming in as frosh, freshmen, they'll have the GE pathway that they're completing in terms of their classes. For those who are coming in as transfers, we're still working to develop exactly what that pathway will be like. It will definitely be focused on Black history, life, and culture, but since they'll have already completed their GE, we have to be more creative in terms of how we do that. So here is the mission of the Honors College. So first of all, our tagline is cultivating the courageous leaders of tomorrow. Because you can be a leader without being courageous. And in fact, if you think about it, while Sacramento State is building a Black Honors College and doing cluster hires focusing on our Latinx community and building out resource centers focused on minoritized students, you see a whole nother part of the country doing the opposite, right? You see people who are railing against ethnic studies, critical race theory, DEI in general, chief diversity officers or senior diversity officers. And so we know that this separates us out. And if you, you know, that's why they say don't read the comments. But they, what folks don't realize is that those comments and those perspectives only give us more fuel to do, because they're only serving to reify the importance of why we have to create a settling experience here. Okay? So the mission. The Black Honors College provides a rigorous, specialized educational experience for students interested in Black history, life, and culture. The college is designed to unite scholars and equip them with the necessary academic, professional, and personal skills needed for economic empowerment, self-determination, and courageous leadership. So this is just some data that helps point out why we thought this was important to take place at Sacramento State. These are campuses in the CSU system based upon total headcount or total enrollment of Black students. And as you'll see, since 2018, we have been the number one institution serving Black students in the Cal State system. A lot of people have assumed that it's Dominguez Hills, because historically Dominguez Hills has served a large population of Black students. And certainly they're up there and definitely in the mix. And President Parham, I think, does an amazing job trying to lead that institution to be a supportive institution for Black students. But make no doubt about it, we're number one. Now, access is not always synonymous with success. Access is not always synonymous with success. And so while we are the number one Black serving institution in the CSU system and number two in the whole state of California, you see that we're also in the bottom third when it comes to success rates. And so what we're doing, as I mentioned, our 75-year history has shown that it's not working the way that it should be. And we shouldn't have our educators have to cobble together an experience to give Black students dignity on this campus. And so we're doing something different. We're creating this Honors College specifically designed to serve students in their own unique environment. Now, how I would compare it is to what you saw with the movement around historically Black colleges and universities, who have given some of, well, have developed, I should say, some of the brightest and most talented minds in the Black community. And I wish for everyone that they could have that kind of experience. And so what we're doing is, we can't be an HBCU because we weren't historically founded early enough, and we don't have, as a university, a mission that specifically focuses on Black and African American students. But we can be everything but the historical, creating an institution within the institution that's specifically designed to serve students from the Black community. Here's some of the, when we talk about resources, here's some of the resources. As we mentioned, this is a multi-million-dollar investment. Some of those dollars are fortunately coming from our Chancellor's office, and we're grateful to some of the support that they're providing us. But you're here right now in the seminar room. So this is the space that we're in currently. Right behind this wall is a room that is basically where our staff will be. So rooms for our counselors, our therapists, our academic advisors, our outreach folks, our admin staff, our dean of students, our director, a conference room that's also in this space. And basically, it's a really, really, really well-done space. We can't show it to you today, because I was always taught growing up, you don't invite friends over to a dirty house. But come back in fall when we do the full launch, and you can see what it looks like. And then around the corner, we also have a study center. And between each of these three spaces, they're almost 2,000 square feet each. Some of them are a little larger than that. So we're talking about over 6,000 square feet of space for the students and the faculty, the staff. So hopefully you can see this is not a minor investment. This is a major investment in our Black students. So before we go to the panel, I want to conclude with what are some of the things that you can do to support us. First of all, we would love and covet your proactive positive support. There will be people who say, this is a terrible idea. There will be people who don't think that educating black minds is worthwhile. And for those of you who've known me over a number of years, for many years I did a class called Black Minds Matter. And we always made comparisons between what happens in policing and what happens in schooling, looking particularly at overplacement in special education and overexposure to exclusionary discipline. And basically, we made those comparisons with the theme of it being that black lives and black minds are intertwined. For if one does not value the life, then they certainly will not value the mind. And so what we need is your proactive positive support to say this is important. We need you to tell people about this. We need you to tell students that they should be looking to Sacramento State as the place to go. Because the truth is, not every campus is going to be committed to doing this. And we can't continue to send students to environments where they're going to experience harm. The second thing is you can encourage applicants, and you can email us at BHC, Black Honors College, at csus.edu. If you're in the business community and you have opportunities, or nonprofit world, and you have opportunities for internships, particularly internships that are paid, we love the free stuff, but our students also need to be able to make it. And so we are looking for internships that can be offered to students. If you have something in mind, please talk to Dr. Ati or to Ruth. Serving as mentors, we're going to be rolling out a mentoring component of this. We're not going to talk about that today. We can talk about that in the fall, but that will be another opportunity. And then, of course, we would also love if anybody is willing to support in terms of scholarships for students. We've got to be able to make sure that we're addressing one of the number one issues that we know students face, which is that they oftentimes don't have the resources to be able to make it. As some of you know, when I was a student here, I struggled with food and housing insecurity. I go a day or two at a time without eating, pick up change off the ground to make my way and be able to go and get something to eat. You know, there was times where I lived in my car, lived in my brother's garage. When my twin brother was in school here at the same time, he was student body president and living in his office because he was unhoused. And so we cannot continue to provide an excellent experience and then not have the requisite scholarships to help to support students. And then transformational namings, if you have a company or know somebody who's got deeper pockets than most, you know, we've got a few rooms that could use a name. Now we're not gonna sell the name of yes anybody now. But all jokes aside, you know, resources are gonna be important. We are going all in as a university to make this happen, but we also need additional resources to be able to make it happen. So with that, I'm gonna be quiet. And so we're gonna encourage you to check out this QR code if you want to get involved, learn about our membership, not our membership list, but our emailing list. And we want to thank you for being here. We want to thank you for your support. And we want to thank you for being part of history in the making today here at Sacramento State on February 19th. So I'm going to turn it over to Linnea to get us rolling on the next part.
All right. Who's excited? Okay. I'm just getting the temperature check, just making sure. So thank you all so much. We did send out a link to all of those who RSVP'd to send in your questions and your comments. If we went through all of them, we would be here till midnight. So we had to cut it down a little bit. But the first question that was asked to us is, what makes the Black Honors College necessary at this moment in time? And I'm going to give that to Ruth.
Thank you, Linnea. Hello, everyone. First, I have to start off by saying happy Black History Month.
Yes.
It is so fitting that we are opening up our Black Honors College in Black History Month. And before I answer the question, I do have to give some brief acknowledgments, because without the people that I'm about to mention, forgive me if I miss your name, today would not be possible. So First, I would like to thank University Communication. That's Jessica, Beebe, Haz. I'd like to thank our CCE media team who are hosting our live right now, Jose, Deb, Susan, Mallory. I'd like to thank the folks, you who in the room are standing this whole time. Thank you so much, I appreciate you. Also, I'd like to thank our admissions team, so Charles and Brian. I'd like to thank our student affairs IT team as well, Susie, Jesslyn, and team. Our VP of enrollment, of course, and the VP here sitting next to me, Anisha. Also, Josie, Araceli, Kristen Tudor here. All of you, our community and partners. Facilities, who put all these chairs in the room. Also, and our ASL interpreters. So thank you to you all. All right. So answering the question, why is the Black Honors College necessary for this moment in time, given not only the history of our country, right, and looking at the success of our students right now, not only did our chancellor's office, so across the CSU system, all 23 campuses, do we see that there is a need to fix the issue of our Black and African American students and their retention rates, but also we at Sac State, we have to do something as well. And so it's completely necessary for this moment in time because, like President Wood said, we have to start now, and we have so many people who are part of our leadership team who are very intentional and loving and caring about this work. And I'll end it there. Thank you.
Great answer. Okay, I'm going to ask the next question. What are you looking for in the faculty that will be teaching at the Black Honors College? And I'm going to pass this one to Dr. Ati.
So, we are looking for faculty who have a demonstrated record of teaching success. They should have. They should be successful in teaching students. They also, okay, can you hear me? Okay. Okay. They should also be able to maintain the rigor, but also have a curriculum that speaks to the vision and mission of the Black Honors College. It is possible to include the history and culture in all the disciplines. I talked to our greatest mathematician on campus, David Ziegler, and we talk about that it is possible to include that type of content in the curriculum. For instance, Black students will come and say, I go to a math class and I hear that all these formulas, these successful formulas, have been created by Europeans or people of Euro descent, but we know that's not true. So there are faculty on this campus who are able to incorporate that type of content in their curriculum. And also, we would like to see faculty who are committed to the success of Black students. And as President Wood said, and have the heart to do it. So we would like faculty to incorporate different methods, who are able to incorporate different methods of assessment. And by saying that, we don't mean that they should lose the rigor. The rigor will also be there. Thank you.
All right. How can Black students from community colleges in California be part of this effort, Dr. Mitchell?
So thank you so much for this question, whomever submitted it. I was really shocked last year to learn that the state of California was providing a one-time grant of up to $5,000 for transfer students who were interested in going to an HBCU. And of course, there's only one HBCU in the state of California, that's Charles Drew University, and that's a graduate school. So I think it's great that students want the HBCU experience. However, I think of the cost of tuition for out of state, and that it's a one-time grant of up to $5,000, so we're getting students there. What will happen to them once they get there? Now, as President Wood indicated in the presentation, we do have spots for transfer students. So if there is a community college student who is interested in being a member of the Black Honors College, we welcome them to apply. There is space for them. They do not need to leave the state of California and forfeit their California financial aid in order to get the HBCU experience now. We can be everything but the historically Black college and university. So there's space for our transfer students and our community colleges.
Okay, for this next one, I would love for Dr. ID and Ruth to touch on this. How is success measured in this college?
Okay, the way we will measure success, we should be able to fill all the 70 spots for applicants. We should be able to retain the students and see them through graduation. We should be able to provide students with paid internship. We should be able to see students who feel nurtured and welcomed. We should be able to see students who are matched with career mentors and then who are happy with those career mentors. And then in the long run, we should be able to graduate and retain all the 70 cohort that is coming in the fall.
Everything that Dr. Masupie just said. One thing I would like to add also, not only are we promoting the success of our students while they're here on campus as an enrollee of the Black Honors College, but also we want them to be set up for after they graduate and after they leave as well. So we want them to be set up with their career as well. Thank you.
All right, now this is a type of resource question. What will the Black Honors College do to support mental health? And I'm gonna give that to Ruth.
Yes, the Black Honors College, we will have an in-house counselor. Mental health is so crucial and so important to us and also to the university. So we will have an in-house counselor that our students don't have to wait, you know, an extended period of time for. If they need help, they can go directly to our counselor that will be on call every day.
Okay, I'm gonna pass this one to Dr. Adi. As a secondary educator, what info is available for high school seniors?
Okay, we have a website, and on the website, we have application. As Dr. Wood said, the applications are opening up tomorrow. We have a priority admission for March 1, standard admission for April 1. After June 1, we are not accepting any applications. High school students should know that if they want to be part of the college, they'll be admitted with 3.5 GPA, and we are not lowering it. However, they'll have support, they'll have mentors, they'll have counselors, they'll have academic advisors, they'll have a very welcoming environment, they'll have an opportunity to interact with other students, they'll have exposure, they'll have an opportunity to listen to different professionals from different parts of the world and different parts of the country. They also should know that the curriculum is going to be rigorous, and then we'll make sure that they get classes that are going to ensure that the classes are productive, and then that will ensure that eventually they will graduate and hopefully on time.
All right. And so one of the most important questions is, how will scholars be considered for the Black Honors College, Dr. Ati?
Hey, well, as I said, they must apply 3.5, and they must have a GPA of 3.5. One of the things that they are going, they will have to do is to answer questions, right? We don't require letters of recommendations. They don't even have to give us their transcripts because we will get them from the registrar. But there are three important questions that we would like them to answer: why they want to be part of the college, how they are going to contribute towards the college, and then to share with us if they have had any challenges, and then how they were able to navigate those challenges. If we get a high volume of applicants, we have the board. So the board will is very, the board of very educated and smart people. They will be they will be able to help us to review their applications.
Okay, I'm also going to piggyback off of this question for Dr. Mitchell. And how would you ensure that this admissions to the program, it's not a program, people, it's a college, but is race blind in accordance with California Proposition 209?
Thank you so much for that question. No, I think it's important to stress again that the Black Honors College is open to all students who have an interest in Black history, life, and culture. We're not saying that this college is solely for Black students. It's open for every single student, and every single student can apply. We're not even asking individuals to disclose their identity on their application. So we're making the admissions decisions based on the admissions applications. Race is not a factor.
We have a few more questions for the panel. Okay. Ruth, how are you going to go about recruiting Black students to attend the Black Honors College?
Yes, so thank you for asking that question and echoing Dr. Mitchell that the Black Honors College is open to all of our students, but also this idea was sparked because of the retention report that President Wood just finished presenting on. So it is our goal to close the achievement gap and to support our Black population of students so that they can succeed. So given that, we're going to go where the students are located, you know? I think we have some former BSU presidents here. Raise your hand, please. Kamiya and Kamaya. Yes. Shout out to them. But we have already begun. We're going into the spaces where the Black students are located. So going to BSU events, going into our MLK Center, connecting with local churches. Do we have any pastors in the room? I believe we do. I saw at least one. Yes, Pastor Choi, thank you. Yes, so we're connecting. We're going where the Black students are located, being intentional with that as well, because we do want to support the success of all of our students. And right now, our Black students' retention rates are the lowest.
If I can add to that as well, if y'all remember the slide that President Wood had in the presentation with the org chart, you may remember that there is an outreach coordinator that's reflected within the Honors College. So we have a designated individual who will be doing recruitment at local high schools and community colleges across the state and eventually across the nation as well.
Okay, I want to ask this question to the panel entirely. Let's forward think. You're a graduate of the Black Honors College. What are you expecting that student to walk across the stage, gaining and going forward into their career?
So I want for our students to truly know who they are and what they are capable of. If y'all have not had an opportunity to read the report that President Wood referenced in the presentation, and we'll put the QR code back up, you can read the report in its entirety. It was extremely sobering to see the success rates of Black students within the state of California. And in my opinion, that's not a reflection of their skills or their capabilities. It's a reflection of us, and us not doing everything that we can do and should do to ensure that they can successfully navigate systems and academies that were not designed for them. So I want for our students, when they graduate, to know who they are and their potential and what they are truly capable of doing, because so many of our students have no clue. So to empower them and to challenge them to not only demonstrate who they are to the world, but to give back to the Sac State community, that is what I want for our graduates.
Well, I want our students to say that I know I can. I went through a college that offered a very rigorous, extremely rigorous curriculum, and I was able to make it. So I am Black, I'm proud, and I'm very smart.
That is a t-shirt. That's good. Yes, and I will close by saying that we're shifting the narrative. We are showing our students that, like Anisha said, that we care, we see you, and you are excellent, and you can and will be excellent. And that will be showcased by their work and upon completion, graduating from the Black Honors College. So pride as well.
And we'll end off with this question. We're getting President Wood to come back in here. But last question for the panel. What excitement have you seen? Because I know the people in here are excited. Maybe some people are still not understanding the excitement that we may have. But what has the response been from our campus community and from the community Sacramento region?
I wish I could share the emails that I have received from people. I wish I could share the emails of professors who are asking me to be part of the Black Honors College, who want to teach for the Black Honors College. I wish I could share the emails that I receive, not only from the campus community, but from outside of the campus. So I, from my perspective and from the emails and the comments that I have from people, there's a lot of support and enthusiasm for the college.
I echo that definitely. The support has been overwhelming. We are so excited, and we know that the community is excited as well. Before this event started just today, Ms. Coty here, she came to me and was just sharing a plethora of ideas, so we're gonna have to connect shortly after this. But also, we also had our first briefing session was with the Sac State campus community, with our staff and faculty. And there happened to be a few students that attended that session as well. And speaking of her own experience, the student, she was brought to tears because this means so much to her to have an opportunity where a student can thrive with Black history, life, and culture in mind as they learn. So it's very important to the students as well, and it's important to us, and we won't let them down.
And retweet everything that has already been stated. Yeah, I have been overwhelmed with all of the support that we have received from the campus community. Now, we have received some hate as well. There's always some haters out there, right? No, President Wood said don't read the comments, but we read the comments and we see what people are saying. But that is going to really reignite a fire under us to make sure that we prove the naysayers wrong.
Okay, we have one final question, and we're going to bring up the man to answer it and wrap this program up. So this is a great example of creative thinking and leadership to support our students. Could this model that get replicated across the UC and the CSU system?
That's right. Well, I appreciate that question because that's part of the intention. Is what we want to be able to do is look back, or we'll look forward 20 years from now and see that there are Black Honors Colleges at colleges and universities across the country. and so that we can create systems within systems that basically can support one another. Now, I also very much worry that what you'll see is someone takes a retention program with two staff, and they're going to rename it into a Black Honors College because they think that is going to give them some sort of advantage. In reality, that's not what we're doing here. This isn't a program, it's a college. And so we do plan to create a set of standards for what would constitute a Black Honors College, and we will be part of basically verifying or vouching for other institutions that are doing this so that when they do it, it's done with the right intention, the right resources, the right people, and with the focus on the Black community. So that's what I would say, that is the vision. And so if we look back, if we get to that point and we've got 10, 15, 20 of these across the country, then we'll be able to say that we did something that was similar to what the HBCUs were able to do in creating access and quality education for the Black community. So that is the ultimate goal. All right. So as we conclude, I want to make sure that we give a few shout-outs. So first of all, I know that we have Assemblymember Kevin McCarty here. Thank you for being here and supporting us. We appreciate you. And for those who don't know, actually, he probably gets annoyed when I bring this up because I bring it up so often, but AB 740 was a bill that we worked on together that basically was based upon the over-suspension of Black students in foster youth. And so what happens is that when you're a foster child and they're going to suspend you or expel you, oftentimes they don't necessarily, they can't necessarily call your family in the same way that you could if you weren't in if you were in a traditional setup. And so partly when I was young, I was suspended a lot. It wasn't because I was a troublemaker, quote unquote. It was because when an educator saw me, they saw a problem, which happens too often with our students. And so very grateful still for the work that we were able to do there in creating better outcomes. So now, based upon AB 740, when a foster youth is being suspended or expelled, any of those kind of proceedings, it has to involve their court-appointed attorney and or social worker so that somebody is in this mix advocating for them. So. I also want to acknowledge that we've got, how many people who joined us online today?
Over 460 now.
460, all right. I also want to acknowledge all the different fraternities and sororities that are in the room. And of course I have to, acknowledge my brothers of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. I'm sure that a few of our panelists would love to call out. But I got the mic. And then I also know that there are several clergy in the room. So if you are, could you just stand up for a moment and be recognized? All right. Well, with that, we're going to, yes, you have a question.
That you use us, because as has already been said, the haters are going to be out there, and they're going to come at you, at the university, at all of this with everything they have. You've got a lot of smart people in this room. Use us to be the response to those people, because we can write the letters, we can do whatever needs to be to get up the word out there that this is the right thing to do in this country. And if we don't start making changes, change is never going to happen. You've got our email addresses. You got everything. Let us know, because we won't know where you get hit every time, because we're not all on the educational, websites and all that. Use us. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
The last thing that we'll leave you with is a website. Please, before the end of the day, if you could go to csus.edu/BHC. And that's where you'll see the landing place. Again, applications open up tomorrow. And so send us your people, and we will take care of them and give them the dignity that they deserve. Thank you. Have a good night.
Thank you.